Rob, what we're going to do now, and in a few moments, Roger and Ralph are going to have a chat. But before we have a chat, we thought we should all charge our glasses and have a toast to our guest of honour. So can you all fill up your glasses?
You stay with
me. Have you all got your glasses charged? So let's toast Ralph. To Ralph.
For he's a jolly good fellow. And so say all of us.
Then, Rob.
All right, if you would all sit down and we'll hand over to Roger now, who is going to have a chat with Ralph.
Well, from my perspective, this is indeed a great pleasure. We have had a little bit of a dry run a few weeks ago, Ralph and I. I sat down with him for a couple of hours and we had a good old chat about his life. We're just going to run through that a bit tonight, and I hope that you'll enjoy it. You've been seeing a lot of the photographs up there, and some of them might mean something when we get through what we talk about. But I'll just start off with saying, Ralph, how come you were born in London on the 24th of June 1918?
Well, that's because Mum was there.
And Dad turned up, did he?
No, Dad was in New Guinea with Mum and Phyllis, and I suppose it would have been about 1915, somewhere around there, and a passing white man shouted across the water to him that Britain was in the war in Europe, and Dad immediately packed up his things and took his wife and daughter and sailed back to England, joined the British Army as a padre and served in France, and then he got compassionate leave, or is it passionate leave they get in there?
Very passionate.
And my sister was born in March, my second sister was born in March 1917, and yours truly arrived in June 1918.
And then you went back to New Guinea, or you went over to New Guinea. You hadn't been there at that stage.
I hadn't been there, no. I had my first cruise in the end of 1919.
Oh, sorry, you didn't know much about that one.
No, well, they say I learned to walk on the boat coming out. I'm not sure whether that would be true, but if I did, I probably stood up and the boat rocked and you rushed for the rails then.
So do you remember much about the New Guinea experience? Because although you went there when you're only one or two, you were there for a little while.
There for 6.5 years. Spoke the Gwariwari language because my only friends were black. Used to swim in the old waterfall. I remember quite a bit about it. I remember the snakes because the snakes used to raid the chook house. Dad would get up in the middle of the night with his shotgun and clean them up, and then I'd need Mum's help to get to sleep again. But yeah, I remember a bit of it.
How did Dad get around in his missionary role?
Well, Kikori was a delta area, and that's why he built his two boats to get around and visit each of the villages, which were all cannibal villages in those days. And that's, I think, where Mother's nerves began to go, because he would disappear to contact another cannibal village, and she would wonder if she'd ever see him again. She had three kids with her. I often wonder whether he became a missionary with cannibals because his name was Butcher.
Oh, that's an absolute classic. tell us about why you went back to London in and in 1933 something significant happened, didn't it?
Yes, Dad was asked to come back to England and speak at the Royal Albert Hall. By this time he was fairly well known as a speaker, and also there was in England there was a great deal of interest in New Guinea and also a very strong group helping missionaries. And so Dad went back to speak at the Albert Hall, took us all back, the whole family, so that was another cruise. And then at the end of the Albert Hall talk, he called his children to him and said, "I've made a mess of your education already, so I'm putting you in boarding school in England and going back to New Guinea on my own," which he did.
And tell us about your family at that stage, your immediate family.
I had a brother. My Phyllis had died. She died of Blackwater fever in New Guinea, age seven. There were no other white people there but Mum and Dad, so there was nothing they could do for her. We all got malaria and suffered with that in that area. But the number of the children.
In your family, yeah.
Yes, well, there was myself and Hilary and David. David was the youngest. He was 6.5 years younger than me. So there were four of us originally, but only three at that time.
And then, of course, you got involved in the war. And we couldn't understand, as Australians, why you were with the bombs. What happened?
Well, what happened was that I finished my education and tertiary studies in London just as the war started, 1939. And I went to Australia House and volunteered for service in the Australian Army. And I was told that if you want to join the Australian Army, you've got to go back to Australia. You can't join here. So you've got to get money and a boat and off you go. My brother found the same thing years later when he joined up. The German army by that time was getting fairly close to the Channel coast, and the belief was that we would be in England would be invaded. And so I thought the best thing I could do was join the British Army.
And you spent about 7 years there?
6.5 years.
Six and a half army, years, yeah. Yes. And where did that take you during the world, in the First World War years?
Well, the first year.
Second World War, sorry.
Second World War. Yes, I did have 5 months in the First World War.
You didn't graduate.
Oh, you haven't missed the boat there. It's amazing, isn't it? He's just picks up so many things. It's amazing. Anyway, tell us a little bit about your service and.
Yes, well, I had the first year. Of course, the first thing you do is you go to a training department for a division for about 6 months. And then I was sent up to the Military College of Science because I'd worked as a major subject applied optics. And they promoted me with three stripes and a crown as an armoured artificer staff sergeant and told me I would keep it if I passed the course, but if I failed it, they would strip it off me. So it's one way of giving you great encouragement when you go. I was scared to death of failure. And the course required a theory, which I did top, say I was sort of top the course in theory, but I failed in the practical side of soldering and filing and all this kind of thing. And so I was terrified I'd lose my stripes. But he said an amazing thing to me, "You failed, but I think you're officer material."
what rank did you get to eventually?
Well, it saved my skin because I kept my stripes. But you want to know where I went with that?
Yeah, where you went to in
I was sent to Egypt, and I was sent to Casrenil Barracks on the Nile to do an officer's training course. And all the people there were people who had been in action in Egypt and Libya. And I got my first pip and went up into Libya to join a new unit. And you want to go on with the war?
Yeah, absolutely.
And then the retreat to Al Alamein, and then posted to a unit that was getting ready for the invasion of Sicily, which, by the way, was the largest amphibious landing in the world had known at that time. There were two armies, the American Army and the 7th Army and the Australian 8th Army, which had just cleaned the Germans out of Africa. And well, there were over 2,000 ships, including about 6 of Britain's battleships. So it was a very big deal. And I was promoted to captain at Syracuse, which is the port in Sicily where we were going to make our supply centre. And then from there we went up the east coast of Sicily and across Messina Strait. The Americans didn't follow us into Egypt there, they landed up the coast later. Spent about 14 months in Italy. Italy surrendered very quickly, and it was a bit of a joke amongst us because he then declared war on Germany. We weren't sure that was helpful.
Yeah, we took the good thing. Is there something or some things very special, you know, that happened during your service in that time?
How long have I got?
I knew you'd say that because when we chatted about it, it went on for a fair time.
Well, it did. Yes, well, I think probably one of the unusual things which I remember, having said I was in Italy, we then were moved down to Barabari, on the Aegean coast, and we then liberated Greece. So we sailed around to Piraeus and went ashore there and liberated Greece. And sat back to wait for victory in Europe Day. And to our amazement, we started finding dead bodies in the streets. And the authorities said we must treat this as a Greek internal matter, not interfere. But we've soon found that the number of bodies was expanding, and it was ELAS, a Greek communist partisan group that had fought with us, was now intent on taking Greece into the Russian sphere. And so we had a rather unpleasant war against civilian-clad people and that kind of thing. And I notice that you're getting a little agitated, so I'm talking too long.
No, they are very, very interesting little pieces, and particularly the Greeks.
Yes, it's a very different thing fighting civilian-clad guerrillas to an army. You don't know who's friend, who's foe, and you get sticks of dynamite and you get... I'm not holding this right, I think. I'm sorry about that.
You're right.
Yep.
Yes, so it's something that you do remember because it's not a normal war.
Just moving on a little bit, when you came back to, well, I say back to Australia, but you came to Australia in 1947, just shortly after the war, and you had 23 years with the big Australian, BHP. How did that come about, and what was your roles there?
Well, I wanted to get into human resources. Yeah. And to my amazement, no company seemed to have a human resources department at that time. So BHP offered me a job in training. They were very strong in training. And I started at the bottom as Master of Apprentices with 300 apprentices at the steelworks. And we went from there and slowly developing into the personnel and human resources.
Must have been a great experience, 23 years of a big company like that.
Yeah, I finished up Executive Officer of Personnel and Training. And by that time, we'd introduced our own residential management course, and we were sending some of our senior people to MIT and Harvard and places overseas for management courses and so on. So I got close to a human resources department at the end of it.
And then you went to another giant firm in CRA Rio Tinto for 12 years. Did you get pinched there, or did they approach you?
Yes, I was chased by what people call headhunters. And this fellow rang me every month. And I would say, and what is the company? And he refused to tell me the company.
Oh.
But he said, that's confidential. They want you, and they said we're not to tell you who I am. So after 3 months, he suggested I write down what I'm getting at BHP, you know, superannuation and income and any benefits. And within a week, I got a phone call to go to one of the hotels in Melbourne, and they offered me the job of personal manager at CRA Rio Tinto. I finished my 12 years there, and retirement in the industry, mining industry, is pretty young. I was 62. I thought I was too young, so I did 3 years of consulting, and the firm that wanted the help was Liquid Air.
And how come you went there? Did they approach you too again?
Well, the management consultants suggested me, and so I went there, and I spent about 3 years with them. I had an interesting experience there, which has nothing to do with what you were going to ask me, Robert.
No, we're always interested in the interesting experiences.
Well, a French director came out to Liquid Air, because the French name, I think, is Air Liquide. And I got to know him. I found he was a very nice fellow, and then I found he was very keen on golf. So I took him to Yarra Yarra to play 18 holes, and we had lunch at Yarra Yarra. His name was Bittergon, brother of the French president. And then he gave me a card, visit me anytime you're in Paris, and I've got back.
Now tell me, just moving on a little bit from there, you had, in your semi-retirement, you had some wonderful tours with your late wife, Chris. Can you tell us a little bit about some of those things that happened?
Well, Chris and I both travelled before we married. Chris had 4 years in America, and she visited New Orleans and Cape Cod and a few places like that. But we did set out to travel a lot, and we did a lot in the Pacific. I've got a lovely picture of Chris and I in Tahiti, and we did the Four Islands of Hawaii and then near Fiji and all those places. We saw a lot of America. BHP gave me a trip through America for about a couple of months because they wanted me to find out a little bit of human resources work. But so we saw quite a bit of America. We were planning to see the Rockies, but Chris developed breast cancer, and we had to cancel the 8 days before we were scheduled to go, and I never did get back to the Rockies. We saw a lot of England. Being an English girl, we'd go over there and stay with relatives, and that meant we could go over there for a long while. And the relatives would drive across the channel and we'd just decide where we'd go. We never booked hotels, we just drove, and if we liked a place we stopped. We got stopped in one pass going over to see one of the mountains, I can't think of it at the moment. So we turned around and my driver, my friend and the relative, just drove through the tunnel to Italy. And we stayed at Lake Como. You could do those kinds
beautiful
of things.
Beautiful Lake Como.
Yes, it is. And the distances are so small for an Australian that it's easy.
Just down the road.
That's right. And that's the way we played Europe. We went to a lot of places.
And wonderful memories for you and Chris.
Wonderful memories, yes.
Now tell me, we haven't talked about the family, but we've got to give them a bit of a mention, haven't we?
My family?
Yes.
Well, they're a very difficult lot. But, one of them has just said absolutely, so she agrees. I've got two girls, Sue and Jen, and we've got four grandchildren, or I've got four grandchildren. Both of them have a son and a daughter. And I have one great-granddaughter who's 3 and a half. When I blew out my candle at Victoria Golf Club on Sunday, she was quite upset. Her job is to blow out candles.
wonderful to have them here tonight with their husbands. And
yes, thank you very much.
And I'd like to just thank you for coming, and we very much appreciate that. Just to perhaps finish up, you've had a wonderful time at Legacy. What has been your highlights there? But why do you spend so much time looking after these legatees? And you've done a wonderful job, I might add, and recognised with your OAM.
Well, I felt fairly strongly about the widows and the kids. And there's a little story about Legacy where two diggers are mourning their mate in the First World War who's just been killed. And one says to the other, "What's the very best thing we can do for Bert?" And the other one replies, "Look after his missus and his kids." And I felt very much like
that. Really struck home.
That really struck home, and I joined Legacy in 1949. I was demobilised in 1946. And I've been with Legacy. I'm still with Legacy. We started
14 widows.
Well, that's what's left.
There were more.
Well, I got up to, in the very early days, in 1949, I got up to about 100. But all you could do in those days, straight after the war, was make sure they help them get all their benefits they're entitled to, and check their homes and get help with things like that if needed, and then leave your telephone number and say, "Now ring me if you need further help." You just couldn't have regular visits, but now with 14, it's possible. Only Vic Rose have upset things by taking my right to drive out.
But you are going to get your licence again soon, aren't you?
I'm going to have to be assessed.
Going to be assessed?
You wouldn't like the job, would you?
I might give it to you. Now, a little later in the year, when you go up to the Government House, you'll get all your Order of Australia, and so you'll be able to put another little medal up there, a little piece on your along with Legacy and Probus.
I won't be able to fit them in because the Probus Legacy had the RSL. I took that out because I wanted the Probus one. Yeah. Now I'm going to have another one.
Yeah, well, it's got to be on top. The Order of Australia is something very special, and I'm sure, you know, when you realise how important it is and what you've done for the community, it's absolutely fantastic, Ralph.
Well,
and I'm going to ask you now. We've finished having a chat, I think, aren't we? Unless you want to have the last word.
I'm just going
to say, have the last word, yeah.
I'll have the last word. Apart from Legacy, in 1949, a Brigadier John Mayne called to see me, and he told me that the government was very worried about Indonesia, now over 200 million people, and we less than 20, and also worried at the weakness of the regular army in Australia due to demobilisation. And then he said, what we're going to do is we're going to build up the CMF so that we've got a pool of partly trained soldiers we can call on. And then he turned to me and he said, "Will you please form and command 111 Infantry Workshop?" So I did that for 6 years until I was sent down to Melbourne.
One more question. I nearly forgot it.
Some chat.
When you're with the specialist, what did the specialist tell you?
About my eyes.
When you're with a specialist.
Vascular.
When you're with a specialist.
The vascular surgeon, I had an aneurysm at the bottom of the aorta, so it was a bit of a worry. And he said the real worry wasn't the operation, it was the anaesthetic. But the specialist, when he came around and saw me, he said, "I'm going to give you a pacemaker because you can't go and get a heartbeat of 35 again. It's not good for you." So he then said, "I don't know, Ralph, you look pretty young to me, but boy, when I saw your vascular system, that's over 100.
Well, we might finish on that very happy note, because he said, "When am I coming back again?" Well, you asked him, and you said, "Well, when?"
He sent me a review That is the 4th of April 2019, a year away, and then the cardiologist did exactly the same thing. So, fellas and ladies, I'm here till April.
Now, that finishes the chat. We're now going over with the family to cut the cake, and that's when we'll have the opportunity, girls, of singing Happy Birthday.
Birthday to you, happy birthday to you, happy birthday dear Ralph, happy birthday to you.
Blow the candles out and then cut the cake.
Bye, Ralph.
Hey! Anywhere you like. So Ralph's going to cut the cake. If he goes to the bottom, he'll have to kiss the nearest lady. This is his eldest daughter, Sue.
This way?
Hey! Congratulations. Well done. That was fantastic. Thank you. You want more photos?
Terrific, Ralph. Well done.
You want more photos?
Okay.
Ten. 10. 20. 30. 40. 50. 60. 70. 80. 90!
100!
Well done.